All right, check, check, check. Welcome to Disciple Dojo. We are going to be taking a very cursory look today at the Septuagint. Sometimes you'll see it called the LXX. What is it? Why does it matter? Just going to give a quick overview, and I'm going to let you know about some versions of the Septuagint out there for those who want to dig a little deeper. So before we jump into that, if you haven't already, go ahead, click that subscribe button, enable notifications. We have got some cool stuff coming up. We're going to start doing live streams. The only way you'll know about those is if the notifications are turned on. That's also the only way that you're going to know about the different giveaways that we do. We give away a lot of resources here on the channel. We're going to continue to do that. So if you want to stay in the loop, enable notifications, and that will let you know what's going on here at Disciple Dojo so you don't miss out. All right, let's talk Septuagint. Now, right off the bat, I want to say up front, I want to make it very clear. My focus is Old Testament Hebrew Bible. Now, thanks to my friends at Biblingo and at Glossa House, I am working as best I can to get my Greek to a little bit higher level, and primarily so that I can read more from the Septuagint. When you take Greek in seminary or a Bible college, typically it's going to be focused on reading the New Testament. And so you get a little bit of Septuagint, but not very much. The focus is on New Testament vocabulary, New Testament concepts. And Septuagint study is just left for people who are going to go further in their master's or doctoral work. But the Septuagint is super important. It always has been. When I reviewed the Orthodox Study Bible here on the channel, I got a lot of comments, and I still get a lot of comments. That video has, it's like the little video that could. It just keeps on chugging. I still get comments from a lot of Septuagint-only people. Like, there are some people, especially if they are in Greek Orthodox traditions, they are to the Septuagint the way King James-only is are to the King James. And now, people who didn't bother to watch that review but just sort of assumed the content based on a meme they saw or the thumbnail or the fact that I was a Protestant reviewing their study Bible, some of them jumped to the conclusion that I'm anti-Septuagint, that I am anti-Apocrypha, that I don't put any value in it, or some other nonsense. Not at all. I'm very pro-Septuagint. I think you have to incorporate Septuagint if you're studying the Old Testament. But I do maintain that the Septuagint is and always will be a translation of the original inspired Hebrew scriptures, not the scriptures themselves. And so some people say, oh, but they're older than the Masoretic text. Well, I agree. I don't think the Masoretic text is the original inspired Hebrew scriptures. I think it is a witness to the original inspired Hebrew scriptures, as are the Dead Sea Scrolls, as is the Septuagint. So I am all for text critical work when studying any part of scripture, Old or New Testament. If you want to know more about that, check out our video course here on the channel. It's entirely free, called Bible for the Rest of Us. And in particular, check out the section where we talk about translation theory and manuscripts, text criticism. That'll give you an idea of where I'm coming from as somebody who does see scripture, the original inspired, authoritative words of God to his people given to us through human writers. But because there was so much interest and people asking about the Septuagint on the Orthodox Study Bible review video, I wanted to do an overview video, an introductory video, and that's what this one is, and then show you some of the options that are out there if you are looking to read the Septuagint, whether in Greek or in an English translation. So this is not a deep dive on the Septuagint. Right off the bat, some people say Septuagint. I say Septuagint. That's just because that's how I learned to pronounce it. I don't know which is original. Pronounce it how you want. But when I say the Septuagint, what I'm talking about is the Old Testament books in the Hebrew Bible that were translated into Greek by Greek-speaking Jews, mostly in Alexandria, Egypt, in around the 3rd, 2nd, 1st century BC. Those were the writings that were considered scripture. And along with those, there were other works that were composed during that time, that were collected, that were included in collections of books. Those came to be known as the apocryphal books to Jews and Protestant Christians, or deuterocanonical books to Orthodox or Catholic believers. So what does Septuagint mean? Where does that name come from? Sometimes you'll see it abbreviated with a Roman numeral, LXX. If you remember your Roman numerals from elementary school, that is the number 70. And it's because there's a tradition, there was an old pseudepigraphical writing. It's called the Letter of Aristeas. It was written to kind of give the background to how the Septuagint came about. So in this article from the Lexham Bible Dictionary, I think this is a great one-paragraph summary of the Letter of Aristeas and what it is and how the Septuagint came about. And it records that Alexandrian librarian Demetrios of Phaleron petitioned the king of Egypt to add, quote, the law books of the Jews to the collection of books acquired by the Ptolemaic Empire. So he said, we want to get the law books of the Jews. Now that's shorthand for the Torah. And that would necessitate the translation of the Hebrew scriptures into Greek. And so the Ptolemaic king granted Demetrios' request and sent his envoys with gifts to be presented at the Jerusalem temple. In response, the high priest selected 6 men from each of the 12 tribes, 72 in total, and sent them to Alexandria to translate the Hebrew scriptures into Greek. Again, you read all this in the Letter of Aristeas. Then upon arriving in Egypt, the 72 Jewish translators succeeded in answering philosophical questions posed by the king. So he quizzed them on their arrival to make sure that they were legit and that they could handle this monumental task. They subsequently carried out their translation of the Hebrew text. After being rewarded by the king, they returned to Palestine. Now, there's more to this legend of how this came about. These 72 translators, they were all separated. They were all put into different houses and they worked for the exact same period of time. And then when they all came back together and they all compared their translations, all of their translations were identical. And so this is kind of put forward as this is how we know that the Septuagint is the inspired words of God in Greek to Jews who no longer spoke Hebrew as their primary language, and to the world who needed to read the Hebrew scriptures. So people who take the Letter of Aristeas seriously as a historical document would say this shows that the Septuagint is how God preserved what we call the Old Testament for all the world for all time. Now, whether or not you believe this and consider it historically accurate, I personally don't. I think this is an urban legend. It's a folk tale. I don't really see anything compelling about it. However, the idea of 72 translators, that got rounded off to the 70. And that became the shorthand for the translation of the Torah into Greek, the LXX, the 70. Now, after this, not during this time and not by these 72 translators, because they were only translating the Torah, but after this, over the next few centuries, other Old Testament books got to be translated as well, the prophets and the writings. And even books were translated or were originally composed in Greek by Hellenized Jews outside of Jerusalem, and those books are part of what came to be known as the Apocryphal or the Deuterocanonical books. And so that's why you'll find them in collected editions of the Septuagint. Now, during the time of Jesus, most readers of the Old Testament were reading it in Greek. We find traces of the Septuagint among the Dead Sea Scrolls. We see authors like Paul quoting from the Septuagint. The early church fathers, most of them read primarily the Septuagint. Some of them may have been able to read Hebrew. Of course, Jesus and all of his original disciples would have been able to read Hebrew. So it's not like the Hebrew text was abandoned, but the Septuagint was a widely used translation of the Hebrew text, even among early Christians. So much so that later, around the 2nd century, non-Christian Jews who believed that the Old Testament should be available in Greek, but saw that Christians were making use of Old Testament passages in Greek and drawing out significance from how the Septuagint translated certain passages in the Old Testament, they produced other translations of the Old Testament into Greek. So that's where you get Aquila. Aquila produced his translation in Greek of the Hebrew scriptures as a non-Christian Jew. And then later, there were others who produced translations of the Old Testament into Greek, guys like Symmachus and Theodotion. So all of this was after the time of Jesus, after the time of the apostles, as there was a widening rift between Jews and Christians over which version of the Hebrew scriptures that they would read. Now, eventually a guy named Origen, he just laid them all out together. He created what's called the hexapla, and it was basically six columns. So you had the Hebrew, like the original Hebrew text, then you had a transliteration of the Hebrew words into Greek in the next column. And then the next column, you would have the Septuagint. And then the next column, you would have like Aquila or Theodotion, or you had the different, the old Greek, other versions kind of put side by side. And that's what Origen prepared so that people could kind of see the difference. So early in church history, Christians were reading a bunch of different translations, comparing them, and there wasn't just one holy inspired textual family that all Christians everywhere were reading from. Now, over the centuries, there came to be basically three collections of the Septuagint that were pretty well preserved. So Codex Vaticanus, Codex Sinaiticus, and Codex Alexandrinus. And they're named for location: Vatican, Sinai, Alexandria. I don't have physical copies of the facsimiles of these, but digitally here in Accordance, you can see the three different codexes and you can compare them in the style of Greek that they were written in. So in terms of modern editions of the Septuagint, you're going to have basically two different types of text. You're either going to have an eclectic text, and that's where text critical scholars pored over all of the sources, compared the manuscripts. They did what we talk about in Bible for the Rest of Us. They did text criticism to try to piece back together what is the original Septuagint translation of whatever edition of the book in the Septuagint we're working on produced. What is that? And so that's what you would call that, an eclectic text. It's basically reconstructing the original text based on the idea that no manuscript is perfect, that all manuscripts contain scribal errors. And our job as text critics is to put together and reconstruct the original text as close as we're able. And so that's where you'll have Septuagint editions like Rohlfs' Septuagint, or the ongoing project being done by the University of Göttingen, which isn't finished yet. It's still in process. So not all of the Septuagint books are available from Göttingen, but these editions are what's called critical editions. And so they have an apparatus. Basically, you're reading along in the text, and when there's a part where the ancient manuscripts of that text differ, like Sinaiticus may say this, Vaticanus may say this, Alexandrinus may say this, Theodotion may say this, Aquila may say this, there will be something in the text, the compilers of those editions will put a little note and it'll tell you what manuscripts say what. It's called the apparatus. And so using that apparatus, students of the Old Testament, of the Septuagint, can study the text in minute detail. It also provides a basis for those who want to use that as their translation to work from. The other approach has been called the diplomatic approach. And that's basically, we're going to take the best whole manuscript that we have, which most people would say is Vaticanus, and we're going to translate that. And if necessary, if there's a part that's just unclear, uncertain, missing, there's a piece of it that we may not have in Vaticanus, then we'll look to the other manuscripts to kind of fill in those gaps. But for the most part, we're reproducing the Vaticanus manuscript. And so that's what you have in Sweet's Septuagint. And there's not really a detailed apparatus. It's just giving you mostly one reading. So when it comes to the Greek text of the Septuagint, it's important to know the difference between those two types. So for instance, if you were to pick up from Hendrickson, the Septuagint with Apocrypha, this one volume version, it has Greek and English in it. This is based on Sweet's Septuagint. The two volume reader's edition of the Septuagint, which is also by Hendrickson, this is based on Rohlfs' Septuagint text. Now, when it comes to English translations of the Septuagint, so now we're moving from textual editions in Greek to English translations. You basically have four options. The oldest is the option that's included in the Septuagint Greek English edition by Brenton. This was done in the 1800s, and it's in older English. It's based on Sweet Septuagint, which is why they're included together in this volume. And it's also based on how Greek words were understood in the 1800s. So it doesn't take into account the last 200 and something years of Greek and classical scholarship. Then you have the New English translation of the Septuagint, or the NETS. This is different than the NET Bible, the NET, New English Translation. This is the NETS Bible. the New English Translation of the Septuagint. Now, this one is based on an eclectic text, so it uses Ross, it uses Göttingen where it's available, but it is styled after, intentionally styled after, the New Revised Standard Version. So while they are translating from the eclectic Greek texts that are out there, they're doing so in a way that intentionally matches as much as possible the NRSV. Each of the books in this is translated by a different scholar, and so each book has a slightly different translation theory, and they would say that reflects what the case was with the Septuagint. The later Septuagint books after the Torah were translated by different translators, and they have different feels. And a unique feature of the Nets is it is very intentional about transliterating proper names. So you don't see David in here, you see Dawid. You don't see Joshua, you see Jesus. They keep the Greek spellings of all of the Hebrew names, and as a result, it's accurate and faithful to the Greek text, but it's also jarring or confusing for English readers who are only familiar with Old Testament names based on more familiar ways they've been rendered over the centuries into English. And then the fourth option is the LES, the Lexham English Septuagint. This was originally a digital resource. This was the Lexham English Septuagint interlinear module in Logos Bible software. And it was so widely used and it was popular enough that with the second edition, they decided, hey, let's make this available in print because people are using it and wanting it. Lexham's is not an eclectic translation, it's a diplomatic translation. It's based on Swedes. So it's attempting to do what Brenton did, but taking into account the past two centuries of Septuagint scholarship. So if you don't read Greek, these are your options as English readers. If you do read Greek, obviously, you have more options. So I'll give you a quick overhead flip through of each of these so you see what's going on and you can decide which, if any, of these is right for your own reading and study. So let's start with the reader's editions. These obviously are going to be for people who can read Greek. If you can't read Greek, these will be of no help to you whatsoever. So these are two volumes. They come with these little kind of pseudo dust jackets that are all the rage in biblical publishing these days. And they're pretty substantial. I mean, this is volume one by itself, and this is Genesis through 4th Maccabees. And then this is volume two, which is Psalms through Bel and the Dragon. Why are these so thick? Why does it take two volumes that are each the size of a large study Bible? Well, because these are reader's editions. So reader edition means that you get the text of the Septuagint, and then all of the words that are obscure, they give you a gloss at the bottom of each page. So we'll zoom in a little bit and you can see you have your table of contents of both volumes. You have an introduction. This is going to tell you all about it. There's going to be notes on the chapters and verses because chapters and verses are different between Hebrew and between Septuagint sometimes. And sometimes they're different between the Hebrew and the Septuagint and the English. So there's a lot of differences going on because chapters and verses were added centuries after the texts were written. It tells you the differences. Some of the Psalms are numbered differently in the Septuagint than they are in the Hebrew Bible. There's a note about Jeremiah because the text of Jeremiah in the Septuagint is its own animal. There are basically two versions, if not more, of Jeremiah, and things are moved around and whole portions of the Hebrew text of Jeremiah aren't found in the Septuagint text. And so then they talk about the vocabulary apparatus, and that's all of the stuff at the bottom of the pages. And they basically say there's about 14,000 different words in the Septuagint. So what they say is if the word appears 100 times or less, so any word that appears more than 100 times in the Septuagint, they are assuming you as a reader who has studied Greek, you already know that word. If it's a word that also appears in the New Testament 30 times or less, they'll put that in there. And all those common words, let's say you don't remember words that you should know that are super common, those are listed in the back in the glossary. Maybe you just have a brain fart and you're just like, I can't remember what Adelphos means. And you go, oh yeah, brother. So the glossary is only a few pages, but these are the most common words. These are kind of the words that pretty much everybody that learns Greek at least a year or a semester's worth of Greek probably knows most of these words. They give you some information on how they parse the words, because part of the reader's edition is it parses the word for you. So you know, oh, this is a present, active, indicative, third person, masculine, singular. This is a nominative plural. All those grammatical things that you may not remember off the top of your head, it's telling you what the abbreviations are for those. Then there's an advanced information section for advanced students of the Septuagint. And it talks about, like, what is the Septuagint? It goes into the background, like the state of the actual text, how it came about, how it was compiled, just kind of really digging into it, and then a bibliography for further reading. And then we come to Genesis. So here you can see you've got the text of Genesis, and there are English subject headings, like it's telling you the creation account, and it's laid out on the page to facilitate reading. So it's laid out for clarity. They break up paragraphs, so you have a little space between. You can kind of follow rhetorically what's going on in the text. And then you can see whenever you come to a word. So in arche, apoesen, hateos, ton, uranon, kaiten, gain, ede, gein, auratos. Okay. Aoratos, that's not necessarily a common word. So there's a little footnote there, one. So you go down here and aoratos, invisible, without form. And then the next word, ke akadaskephastos. That's a strange word, but there's a little two. So you're reading along. You can jump down here. Oh, so aoratos is invisible or without form, and akadaskephastos is without shape. This is how the Septuagint translated tohu vavohu, the Hebrew term that means formless and empty. And so this way you can just read along. You don't have to have a lexicon there looking up words. And that's also why it's so thick, because so much of each page is taken up with vocabulary. Sometimes it's more than half the page. So this explains why it's so thick, but this is also why this is so valuable. If you have studied Greek, this is a fantastic resource. Now, some books, there are two versions. I mentioned there are parts of some books where there are two Greek traditions. Judges is an example. There's basically two Judges texts at times. And so what they do is they put them on facing pages. They have A and B. So this is one text of Judges that comes from one Septuagint tradition. This is that same passage from the other Septuagint tradition. So you as a reader are getting both. And volume two, everything's the same. All that beginning information's the same. It just starts with Psalms. So all of the writings, the wisdom literature, and both of these volumes include the apocryphal books that are included along with the Septuagint, like Ben Sira, the Wisdom of Ben Sira, or sometimes it's called Sirach. That's in volume two. Whereas the books of Maccabees, those are history, those would be with the former prophets, those are in volume one. So that is the Septuagint Reader's Edition. These are also available in hardback. I have the leather covers. These are the ones you see sitting behind me on the bookshelf in most of my videos, and that I take down and read as needed from time to time. Your other option, if you want to read the Greek text, is the Septuagint with Apocrypha in Brenton's translation. So Brenton prepared this, and you can see how old it is. I mean, it uses old 1800s typesetting. There's an introduction by Brenton that gives kind of the background of the Septuagint. Again, some of what we talked about. And then the text in this volume looks like this. This is Sweet's version of the Septuagint, which is, again, mostly the Codex Vaticanus, I believe. And it just has the Greek text here and then Brenton's English translation right here. And there are a few footnotes at the bottom that go with Brenton's translation. So you can see this is really small print, really old typesetting, but that's what you get. It's very compact. That's why this is only one volume. Thin, there's no apparatus, there's no glossary, and there's nothing at the end. I mean, it ends with the prayer of Manasseh, and that's it. Now, you don't have to know Greek, obviously, to read the translation part of this, but Brenton's translation, it's very wooden, it's very stilted, it's honestly, it's out of date, and it's public domain. You can find it pretty much anywhere online for free. So most people will choose one of the other options. We've already reviewed the Orthodox Study Bible here on the channel. If you haven't seen that, check it out. But again, this is a modified version of the New King James that takes into account some of Brenton's translation. So it's not really its own thing. And I really wouldn't recommend this as your primary reading of the Septuagint. Now, the NET, you can see it's very thin, and that's because it's only English. There's no Greek here. It's two column. Some books that have multiple traditions, like Judges, it puts it in a double column format. So this is the text, Judges A, this is the text text of Judges B. Same thing with Esther. There are two versions of Esther out there. So there's the old Greek version and then what they call Alpha, and they're translated side by side. The Psalms give you in parentheses the English versus the Septuagint chapter divisions, the divisions of the Psalms, and where the verses differ, they put them in parentheses alongside, and they break it up into poetry laid out on the page, which Brenton's doesn't do. Brenton's is just that block format. But what's unique about NETS, the naming of the books, and the fact that each one is done by a different translator. So here's the table of contents. You have the law. So Genesis, Exodus, Leviticon, Numbers, Deuteronomion. So it's just straight transliterating the Greek title of these books. And each one you can see is done by a different translator. Then in the next section, you come to the history books. This is how this is where our English Bible orders came from, by the way. This is why they're different than Hebrew Bible orders. Our English Bibles follow the order of the books in the Septuagint. They just don't always include the deuterocanonical books if they're Protestant. But you can see, not Joshua, but Jesus. Ruth, spelled the Greek way. And then instead of 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, you have 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th reigns. Sometimes in other Septuagints, these are called 1st, 2nd, and 4th kingdoms. So they're translating that Greek word as reigns rather than kingdoms. And then instead of Chronicles, you have 1st and 2nd supplements. And then instead of Ezra, you have 1st Esdras and 2nd Esdras. You have Esther. You have Judith, which is Judith, Tobit, and then the books of the Maccabees. So these are all deuterocanonical. These are apocryphal books in English Bibles. And so they do the same for the poetic books and then the prophets. And in the prophets, the book of the 12, the minor prophets, come first. And again, these have the Greek names. Abdias, that's Obadiah. Sophonias, Zephaniah. Then you have the major prophets. Esaias, that's Isaiah. Jeremias, Jeremiah. And Baruch, they include that, along with Lamentations, Letter of Jeremias, and then Ezekiel. And then at the end, you have the books associated with Daniel. You have Susanna and Belen the dragon, which are sort of a beginning and an ending to Daniel. And then you have Daniel in the middle. Now, NETS is intended to be used academically and scholarly. There's a great introduction at the beginning. They talk about why they chose to use the NRSV as sort of their guiding foundational translation to build upon. And then there's some technical translation information on how the Greek of the Septuagint modifies Greek in order to fit the Hebrew context of Scripture. And it gets technical. I mean, you have to know a little bit about translation theory to wade through this, but it's really good information. Then what's especially helpful is at the beginning of each book, the translator of that book writes an opening essay on how they approach translating that book. So Robert Hibbert has like a 5.5-page essay at the beginning on how he translated Genesis, what he did with certain neologisms or stereotypes or calques or isolates, Hebraisms, loan words, you know, all of these things that translators have to worry about. They really get into the weeds on it, and they're being transparent with the reader. And then we come to the actual text. So for academic study, this is a great resource. I'm impressed with the New English Translation, with NETS. I have this in Accordance. I always pull it up in Accordance when I'm using that. But if you're looking for a print resource, it's not too big. It's not too bulky. It's published by Oxford University Press. So if you're interested in the Septuagint, this is a good resource. And then lastly, we come to the Lexham English Septuagint. This one is bound a lot nicer, hardback. It's got the nice gilded gold. It's got a ribbon bookmark. And so when you open it up, you're going to come to the contents, acknowledgments, some great names on here. Our friend David Da Silva, our friend Nijay Gupta, my friend Fred Long, Michael Heiser, Bruce Fisk, Emerson Powery. These are a number of scholars who are excellent. And so this is the second edition of the Lexham English Septuagint that is built on that work. There's an introduction, and it has running headings on the outside here in the little like marginalia, actually like that, rather than putting the headings in the text. So what is the Septuagint? That's what these paragraphs are about. The origins of the Septuagint. There's a great discussion, again, of the letter of Aristeas. Now, I will say, you can see on the camera, these pages are super thin. I mean, that's why this is so compact. I don't love that. I love Lexham. Lexham are friends of ours here at the channel, but I'm not loving this paper. be nice to be a little thicker, Lexham. But there's an overview in this introduction of basically what we've been talking about in this video. They talk about the textual basis and the different critical editions, and so what the other Septuagint translations are built from, and that they are intentionally not building on any other English translation. But it is a translation of Sweet's edition. This is kind of like the successor to the older Brenton translation. In fact, with this being published, there's really no need for the Brenton translation anymore, except as a historical comparison. They give you their translation principles. This is a really good and in-depth, but not like this intro was very technical and rightfully so. I mean, this is an Oxford Press academic work. This intro was very scholarly, but not that technical. Then the text, it's laid out in this block format, very similar to Brenton's. They put the headings along the margin. Again, I really like that. That gives you as a reader place to make notes. In this case, because of how thin this paper is, you'd need to use a mechanical pencil instead of ink. But a lot of margin space. I like this a lot. The text is easy to read. It's single column, which I love. They preserve the poetry sections. The Psalms are laid out as poetry. I really, really like the layout of the Psalms. And again, the notes is marginalia. Great touch. There are no book introductions, though. You don't get that explanation that you do get in Nett's by whatever contributor put it together. And the translation overall is intentionally leans to literal. They try to keep the same words used throughout the text so that you're not using a different English word for the same Greek word over and over. That helps the reader see the connections. It doesn't make for as smooth as English sometimes, but it's helpful for studying the text. They want you to know you're reading a translation of a translation, and they want you to read it and hear it the way a Greek reader would have heard a translation of a Hebrew text into their language of Greek. So they talk all about that in the introduction, but there aren't those specific book introductions. And there aren't any resources at the back. After Bell and the Dragon, that's it. End of the book. So basically, if you're looking for an English translation of the Septuagint, these are the options that are out there. I honestly would not recommend using Brenton's. I think the fact that these two are available, this, you don't even need it anymore. So just to compare, we'll end by reading in each of these translations so you can see how it sounds and decide for yourself. So here's what you're going to read in Brenton. In the beginning, God made the heaven and the earth, but the earth was unsightly and unfurnished. And darkness was over the deep, and the Spirit of God moved over the water. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided between the light and the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Here's that same passage in Nett's. In the beginning, God made the sky and the earth. Yet the earth was invisible and unformed, and darkness was over the abyss, and a divine wind was being carried along over the water. And God said, let light come into being. And light came into being. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God separated between the light and between the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And it came to be evening, and it came to be morning, day one. And then here we have the Lexham English Septuagint. In the beginning, God made the heavens and the earth, but the earth was unseen and unprepared, and darkness was upon the deep, and the Spirit of God rushed upon the water. And God said, let light come into being, and light came into being. And God made a separation between the light and the darkness. And God named the light day, and the darkness he named night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Now, for how it handles poetry, I'm going to read Psalm 23 in each translation so you can compare those. So Brenton has, the Lord tends me as a shepherd, and I shall want nothing. In a place of green grass, there he has made me dwell. He has nourished me by the water of rest. He has restored my soul. He has guided me into the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, even if I should walk in the midst of the shadow of death, I will not be afraid of evils. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, these have comforted me. Thou hast prepared a table before me in the presence of them that afflict me. Thou hast thoroughly anointed my head with oil, and thy cup cheers me like the best wine. Thy mercy shall also follow me all the days of my life, and my dwelling shall be in the house of the Lord for a very long time. Now here it is in the Nett's New English Septuagint. This is Psalm 22. In English, it's Psalm 23. A psalm pertaining to David. The Lord shepherds me, and I shall lack nothing. In a verdant place, there he made me encamp. By water of rest he reared me, my soul he restored. He led me into paths of righteousness for his name's sake. For even if I walk in the midst of death's shadow, I will not fear evil, because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comforted me. You prepared a table before me over against those that afflict me. You anointed my head with oil, and your cup was supremely intoxicating. And your mercy shall pursue me all the days of my life, and my residing in the Lord's house is for length of days. And then lastly, we have the Lexham English Septuagint, Psalm 22. And then at the bottom, it gives you a footnote that says this is Psalm 23 in Hebrew, a Psalm of David. The Lord shepherds me, and nothing will be lacking for me. In a place of tender grass, there he causes me to dwell. At a river of rest, he nourishes me. He turns around my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness on account of his name. For even if I should go in the middle of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil things, because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they exhort me. You prepare before me a table opposite those who afflict me. You anoint my head with olive oil, and your drinking cup is satisfying as the best. Your mercy will pursue me all the days of my life, and my dwelling will be in the house of the Lord for the length of days. So this should give you an idea not only of what the Septuagint is, but how you can read it, how you can study it, how you can enter into the world of how Greek-speaking Jews in the time of Jesus read their scriptures for the most part. Like I said, I'm a Hebrew Bible guy. I think study of Hebrew scripture is crucial. It's essential. I think the Hebrew takes priority over the Septuagint as a whole, but I think that the Septuagint has to be consulted because sometimes the Septuagint preserves the correct reading that the Hebrew tradition got wrong. For one example, see our superhero seminary video with Professor Ant-Man behind me on the shelf, where he talks about how tall was Goliath. And in that case, it's most likely that the Septuagint, not the Masoretic text, preserves the correct reading. But that's not always true. So I value the eclectic approach. I think it's helpful. And I'm glad that there are different versions of the Septuagint out there for scholars to sift through, because that shows us the different traditions and it helps us get closer to the original texts of Scripture, whether coming from the Hebrew tradition or the translation into Greek for Greek-speaking Jews at the time of Jesus. So I'm not anti-Septuagint. I'm very pro-Septuagint. I'm just not a Septuagint-onlyist. And I think it is and always will be a translation, so one step removed from the original inspired prophets and authors of the Hebrew Scriptures. My honest thoughts for Dojo viewers out there, I don't think the Orthodox Study Bible is really worth getting if you're just looking to read the Septuagint. I also wouldn't recommend Brenton's. I think it's dated. I think it's hard to read. I don't think it's laid out well. It's very compact. It's affordable because it's in the public domain, but I wouldn't really recommend it. So these two, I don't think you'd have much use for. If you can read Greek, if you've had a semester of Greek at least, spend the money and get the Reader's Septuagint. This is a fantastic resource, and it'll help you get better at Greek while you're reading through the Septuagint. But if you don't know Greek and you just want an English translation, it basically comes down to the NETS or the Lexham English Septuagint. If you're looking for academic study, I recommend NETS. I think the notes you're going to get in it are helpful. If you're doing any kind of translation work, any type of text critical work, anything academic, this is probably what I'd say will serve you better. But in terms of just a good, readable, enjoyable interaction with the Septuagint, I don't think you can beat the Lexham English Septuagint. I mean, my only critique of this is how thin the pages are. That's it. My friends at Lexham did send me this copy to look at and to share with viewers. So I do want to make that clear. They did give me this copy. But even if they hadn't, if I had bought this on my own, my feelings would be exactly the same. This is for the average Dojo viewer out there, for the average non-academic person just looking to read and study and get more familiar with the Greek version of the Old Testament, Lexham English Septuagint should be your first stop. Then if you want to supplement it, pick up a copy of NETS. So this is just a little intro to the Septuagint. I hope it's helpful for those of you out there who've wondered. I hope this maybe piques some curiosity to get back into the Greek Old Testament. If you have any questions about the Septuagint, leave them in the comments section below. And we may possibly be able to have some of these contributors here on the channel sometime to sit down and talk more in depth about the Septuagint. That's what I'm hoping for, at least. That's all for now. We'll see you back here next time at Disciple Dojo. As always, keep training.